All right, I think we're settled enough to get going this morning. Good morning, I'm Richard Newell. I'm the President of Resources for the Future. I want to welcome you to this important conference. Thanks to all of you for taking the time to be here, particularly for those who, many of you who traveled from a long ways to get here. I think Partha Dasgupta gets the prize for farthest travel, and also want to thank Partha for really stimulating symposia that he did yesterday with researchers here at RFF. People really, really enjoyed that. It's also really special to have people here who knew and worked closely with John Crutilla, including Gardner Brown, Charlie Cicchetti, and Kerry Smith, of course. It's great to have the extended and longtime RFF family back here today. I'm also really excited to have a fantastic panel of speakers at this event, and I'd like to welcome back a former RFF fellow Spencer Banzoff, university fellow John List, as well as newcomers to RFF, Eric Hurst and Drone Asimoglu, both of whom we hope to keep engaged with this work as we go forward. We really appreciate you taking the time to consider, think about, reflect on John Crutilla's work, how it intersects with your own research, and also how to bring the work in conservation reconsidered into a modern and contemporary context of environmental and resource and economics more generally. I'd also like to express my sincere thanks to Margaret Walls, a senior fellow here at RFF, and university fellow Kerry Smith for co-organizing this important event. There's a lot of work that went into it to bring together such an excellent, outstanding, and the most important thing in any conference like this is the people. And so we've already checked all the marks there, and so I'm really looking forward to a very stimulating discussion. It took a lot of vision to put this this effort together. The issues that you'll discuss here are more important today than ever. John Crutilla's Conservation Reconsidered paper was the first by an economist to provide a framework for thinking about the values of the natural world beyond extractive values. And I know Margaret is going to provide some current policy context for your discussions, but let me also emphasize how important these issues are today. For example, evaluating the trade-offs between low-cost unconventional oil and gas resource extraction with the value of preservation at a time when demand for outdoor activities is greater than ever, or balancing the many uses of public land, such as renewable energy projects, outdoor recreation, livestock grazing, and wilderness, which also seem to be in increased conflict all the time. It's extremely important that we, as economists, bring our tools, our methods, and our creative and innovative ideas and solutions to these important policy problems. That's why we're so glad to have some of our most creative thinkers in this realm here as panelists today, and to really all of you in the room for what we looked forward to as a very stimulating discussion. So once again, thank you for coming, and I'm now gonna turn it over to Margaret Walls for some further remarks. Thanks everybody for being here.
So thanks so much to everyone for coming. I just wanted to kick off before Spencer gives our first presentation with a few mundane details, the location of the restrooms for one thing. So that's either one, because we are going to have a break, so either go back out towards the Peace Street entrance, there's men's and women's that way, or if you just go around, turn right after you go out, there's also restrooms around the elevators in the other building, or this building we're in. So if you have a question, just ask any of us RFFers. We know where everything is. And I also just want to take this moment to thank some of the people who've been really helpful to Kerry and me in getting this going. First of all, to who's not here, our longtime librarian, Chris Clotworthy, who dug up the photos in the slideshow out there, some of John Crutilla and others. And also Kerry Crutilla, John's son, who couldn't be here today, sent me some of those, so I hope you enjoy them. Thanks to Christine Tolentino for the food and all the logistics, and especially want to thank Christina Hohenau, who some of you have interacted with, all of you have interacted with, and she's been really indispensable. She's sitting in the back here today, so please say your thanks to her. So without further ado, where is Spencer? I'd like to welcome Spencer up.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Is it? Oh, we're going to record. Yeah. All right. I'll go ahead and start. Yes, right. Countdown. I want to start thinking about Conservation Reconsidered by zooming ahead in time to January 23rd, 1979. On that day, the so-called God Squad, an executive committee, met to decide the fate of the Tellico Dam, the latest and what would prove to be the last of a series of controversial dam projects that have punctuated the history of American conservation thought and politics. In this case, the controversy was the snail darter, that small fish you see down there, which was discovered in the waters of the Little Tennessee River, where the Tellico Dam was to be, and was the first important test of the still new Endangered Species Act. So, there's a public meeting. Robert K. Davis gives the staff report. Who will speak next? Charles Schultz, Council of Economic Advisors, clears his throat to speak. An audible gasp from the environmental lobby in the back of the room. Not the economist. But what Schultz had to say surprised them. Look, he said, the benefit-cost ratio for this project was always iffy at best. At best. If you give any credit to that fish at all, it should tip the balance against the project, and we should let it die. Shortly after, a motion passes for just that, to let the project die, at least for the time being. If not for the first time, in a very real and important and public way, the environmental lobby learned that economics could be on the side of the natural environment. The story of John Crotilla and Conservation Reconsidered is a story of how that came to be, and the background to it is the story of why it was so surprising to that environmental lobby. So to set up that background, consider an important schism in the history of American environmental thought and politics. The schism between the conservation side and the preservation side. The conservation side personified by Gifford Pinchot, the preservation side by John Muir. Gifford Pinchot came from a privileged background. His father was a wealthy forester. Pinchot went to Yale and to France and became one of America's first professional foresters. At a very young age, he became one of the first chiefs of what would become the National Forest Society, National Forest Service, and then he started the Society of American Foresters. With his father, he started the Yale School of Forestry, and then eventually he would go on to become governor of Pennsylvania. Pinchot was a utilitarian. He thought in terms of extending Bentham's maxim to the greatest good, to the greatest number, over the greatest period of time. I noticed a subtle shift there from Bentham's greatest happiness to greatest good. Pinchot was also a materialist. He once said that in this material world, there are only two things, people and resources, resources to be used. So his motto was wise use of natural resources as material inputs into productive processes. It's not surprising that he was thoroughly anthropocentric in his outlook. Muir, totally different. Muir came from Scotland. His parents emigrated when he was young to Wisconsin. He grew up on a farm with them. They were largely illiterate. Muir had very little formal education. He was working in a machine shop when an accident left him blind for a couple months. He decided life was too short to do anything but live for his passion. So he hiked from Indiana to the Gulf Coast, then famously hiked the Sierra Mountains, where he fell in love and began the signature project of his life, preserving the area that would become Yosemite National Park. Pinchot and Muir at first were tactical allies against neoclassical economics, what Muir called the gobble-gobble school of economics. Serving on various committees together, they started to fall out when specific policy recommendations had to be made. Pinchot always making recommendations in terms of use for people, Muir wanting to preserve wilderness from people. The epic battle came in the Hetch Hetchy Valley in the Yosemite. After San Francisco's fire, the city petitioned to create a dam in the valley as a source of municipal drinking water. Pinchot argued that, well, it's a beautiful place, sure, but the need is overwhelming. And the whole purpose of conservation is for wise use, and this is a wise way to use this resource for the water supply. Muir, on the other hand, as you can imagine, was apoplectic. Damn Hetch Hetchy, he said, as well Dan the nation's cathedrals, for no finer, not monument, no finer temple has ever been consecrated to the hearts of, by the hearts of man. Eventually, the dam was built. So if you go to San Francisco, you get water from that valley today. But the schism in American conservation thought from that conservation and preservation thought in environmentalism left a legacy that was very important for understanding conservation reconsidered. We can, if economics was on one side of that debate in the first half of the century, it was clearly on Pinchot's conservation side. Criteria were put in terms of national economic development. Nevertheless, there was some dissatisfaction. We can see that dissatisfaction in two ways. The first is in the economics of outdoor recreation in the early beginnings of that in the 1940s and early 1950s. If we read the history of environmental economics, at least the non-market valuation side of it, backwards from today, it's tempting to say that it began with work on the economics of outdoor recreation during that period. And in some sense, that's true. But it's also important to understand that if we call that environmental economics, there's a certain irony here, because that work on outdoor recreation was established, was begun in favor of development projects, in favor of dam building. So basically, to put it baldly, there were bureaucratic pressures to up the benefit-cost ratios so we could build more projects. That would be good for bureaucrats. In a funny way, it turned out to be kind of a farm program, too, because and so far as there were reclamation projects, farmers had to pay the cost of those projects. But if you could net out some of the benefits as going to other purposes, farmers didn't have to pay for that. So the farm lobby was highly in favor of upping these benefit cost ratios as well. So all these pressures on economists in the federal agencies and their bosses, their bureaucratic bosses, to figure out a way to come up with new benefits, and outdoor recreation was suggested as one. You build a dam, you get a lake, you can go fishing and boating. How the heck are we going to do these? How are we going to get benefits for that? The economist said, no idea. Roy Pruitt of the Park Service sent out a survey of a number of economists. And if any of you know about that, you probably know about it through Harold Hotelling's letter that first suggested you could use the travel cost model for establishing the benefits of recreation. How far do people go? Think of that as a price they pay. The time they're willing to spend in traveling is a kind of a price. And that's an important part of Pruitt's process. But he was one person in the survey, and he was totally ignored. He was totally ignored as this is just sort of a bizarre suggestion. 12 out of 13 economists surveyed said it couldn't be done. Can't be done, don't try. Can't be done for two reasons. First of all, recreation is intangible, it's spiritual. As Muir would have said. And second of all, maybe there's some other intangible and spiritual things, like listening to a Beethoven concert, but those are traded in markets. You can buy recordings or tickets to concerts. And this isn't traded in markets, so we don't have any signal. So it can't be done. Pruitt's conclusion was this. Recreation is, first of all, an intangible service. It is not a standardized or homogeneous service. It varies with every individual, and it cannot be considered separate and apart from the individual. It is of the mind and body. It cannot be stored or transported. It is a psychic value, and it cannot be measured in objective terms. Finally, the recreational values supplied by the National Park Service are not sold for a price under marketplace rules. It might be better to forget the words economic value of recreation and focus attention on the expenditures induced by recreation. It is in this area that an objective approach can be made. So we're economists, we're scientists. Recreation, that's like spiritual and tangible stuff, but expenditure, that's facts. We can do something with that. Not everyone was satisfied with that, but that was the compromise that was made. Another very different perspective on the dissatisfaction left by the legacy of the Pinchot-Muir split comes from Aldo Leopold. Leopold started his career as a forester following in the footsteps of Pinchot. He went to Pinchot's Yale School of Forestry and then worked in the Forest Service when Pinchot was chief. He started very much in a mindset of Pinchot's narrow material uses of forest products. With the Forest Service kind of broadened out to multiple purpose management of forests for recreation and other things. And then eventually became dissatisfied with that too, appreciating Muir's perspective of valuing things for their own sake. He left the Forest Service and went on to go into the Agricultural Economics Department at the University of Wisconsin. His training at Yale is sort of, we would say, interdisciplinary today. So here he is at the Agricultural Economics Department. And in thinking about the values of preserving wilderness, he basically says economics has nothing to say about it. In his famous book, A Sand County Almanac, he says this: "Sometimes in June, when I see unearned dividends of dew hung on every lupin, I have doubts about the real poverty of the sands. On solvent farmlands, lupins do not even grow, much less collect a daily rainbow of jewels. If they did, the weed control officer, who seldom sees a dewy dawn, would doubtless insist they be cut. Do economists know about lupins?" Apparently not, he says. Those are lupins on the left. He goes on: "One basic weakness in a conservation system based wholly on economic motives is that most members of the land community have no economic value. Wildflowers and songbirds are examples. Of the 22,000 higher plants and animals native to Wisconsin, it is doubtful whether more than 5% can be sold, fed, eaten, or otherwise put to economic use. Yet these creatures are members of the biotic community, and if, as I believe, its stability depends on its integrity, they are entitled to continuance. When one of these non-economic categories is threatened, and if we happen to love it, we invent subterfuges to give it economic importance. At the beginning of the century, songbirds were supposed to be disappearing. Ornithologists jumped to the rescue with some distinctly shaky evidence to the effect that insects would eat us up if birds failed to control them. The evidence had to be economic in order to be valid." So what's Kutila saying here? We're sort of in this trap that we want economic rationale for preserving wilderness, but really there is no economic rationale. So these insect-eating services provided by nature, it's kind of pathetic, is what he's saying, right? So he wants to establish an interdisciplinary ecological economics, was his term, and argued that economics is important, of course, because incentives matter and property rights matter, but when it comes to understanding the basis for values for preservation, economics has something to say about that. We need a new land ethic. Enter John Kutila. Kutila got his PhD from Harvard in 1952. He went to TVA for 3 years and then to RFF in 1955, where he remained until his retirement in 1988. Kutila loved the outdoors. By all accounts, anytime there was a project somewhere, he'd want to go on a field trip. He had a cabin in Shenandoah, I believe it was, where there were frequent visits. He liked reading Leopold and Muir and so forth. He was a fan of theirs. But early in his career, his economics showed little engagement with the Muir-Leopold point of view. In retrospect, one could say that it was a successful career early on, but that it was moving forward in an existing intellectual landscape, not really changing that landscape. Probably among his most important work is the book with Otto Eckstein, Multiple Purpose River Development, published in 1958. And that book advanced in important ways the benefit-cost analysis of dam projects, looking at opportunity costs of capital, considering indivisibilities, and so forth. They looked at four case studies, one of which is particularly interesting for the history is the Hell's Canyon Dam on the Snake River. Environmental historians think the battles over the Snake River are particularly important. The background to multiple purpose river development is that there were two rival projects on the river, a New Deal progressive version where the federal government would build a huge dam, and another version preferred by Republicans where private industry would build a series of smaller dams. They analyzed those projects in the book and came to the conclusion that there actually should have been a convex combination of the two, some medium-sized two-dam project. But most important, when they thought about preservation values of the wilderness there, they said, yeah, they're there, but those are extra economic considerations. Like Leopold, like the people in the Pruitt report, they argued economics really doesn't have anything to say about that. It's not to say it's not important, but there's economics and there's that other stuff. We're going to leave that to other people to think about. In the early to mid-1960s, something seems to have changed. Kutila made a deliberate pivot to start thinking more about how we can incorporate the values of preservation and wilderness into economics. He started taking courses at the USDA and other places in agronomy and geology and so forth. And then he unleashed, if you will, Conservation Reconsidered in 1967. Here's an important quote from that article that I think captures it in a nutshell. The traditional concerns of conservation economics, the husbanding of natural resource stocks for the use of future generations, may now be outmoded by advances in technology. On the other hand, the central issue seems to be the problem of providing for the present and future the amenities associated with unspoilt natural environments. When the existence of a grand scenic wonder or a unique and fragile ecosystem is involved, its preservation and continued availability are a significant part of the real income of many individuals, namely the spiritual descendants of John Muir, the present members of the Sierra Club, the Wilderness Society, and others to whom the loss of a species or the disfigurement of a scenic area causes acute distress and a sense of genuine relative impoverishment. Okay, so go back to the earlier split between Pinchot and Muir representing the conservation side and the preservation side. Right? It's Pinchot's conservation economics that Kutila wants to reconsider in Conservation Reconsidered. That's the traditional concern of economics, of natural resource economics, husbanding natural resource stocks for the future use of generations, but it may now be outmoded. It's interesting because RFF was founded very much in a spirit of that first paragraph of conservation economics. The Paley's Commission work being motivated by the concern that we have to harbor our resources to outlast the communists. But in the next 10 or 15 years, RFF also established important work showing that we weren't seeing increasing scarcity in natural resource stocks. Prices aren't going up. Right? Maybe that's not such a concern after all. Instead, what is getting more rare? The wilderness, right? The natural environment. And so we need to rethink the importance, the relative importance of those two, and think about preservation, the code word for Muir's work, the spiritual descendants of the Sierra Club started by Muir and so forth. Kutila introduced a number of important ideas, some key ideas in his article. The first is that what we really have here is an opportunity cost. Anytime we're thinking about conservation versus preservation, development, if you will, versus preservation, you can only have one or the other. So if you develop the resource, that comes at the opportunity cost of preserving it in its wilderness state. If you preserve it, of course, you can't get the natural resources that you would have from development. But those values for preservation that the spiritual descendants of Muir and Leopold have, those are real values too. They're part of the real income of people. So we have a kind of value for just the existence of a natural environment, come to be called existence values in the literature. And that's the first point. There's always an opportunity cost. That makes the decision economic, no matter what. Second, there's asymmetric technical change. We seem to be having an increasing availability of substitutes for the material inputs that were the concern that motivated the conservation Pinchot side of the spectrum. So he gives the example of nuclear power or other sources of power that are coming online to make coal less important. Right, so maybe we don't need the coal mine if we have substitutes for the coal. We can preserve the mountain in a natural state. Asymmetric technological change. Because on the other hand, for preservation, we're not getting substitutes in the same way. We don't get technical change that provides substitutes for the wilderness. And that's and so those are becoming increasingly scarce, whereas the materials aren't. And there's two reasons why the natural environments are becoming increasingly scarce in an economic sense. First is the irreversibility of development. Just like when you take coal out of the ground and you burn it, you can't put it back. When you develop a natural environment and turn it into some other kind of state. If you pave paradise, you can't unpave it. So there's an irreversibility there. And an irreplaceability. Right? There's an irreplaceability as well. You can't just build a new natural environment, because then it wouldn't be natural anymore. Second reason for the increasing scarcity, of course, is the public good nature of the problem that we all understand. Right? There's a lack of market institutions that can capture all the rents. Unlike, say, agricultural land, where you can capture the rents because there's excludability and just one person to charge, you can get all the Ricardian rents from that land. Either there's a problem of excludability entirely, so that you can't charge anyone, or even if you could, because multiple people are using the resource because of the non-rivalry, because multiple people are using it, you'd have to come up with some scheme where there's a perfectly price-discriminating monopolist to capture all the rent. It's hard to imagine how to do that. So institutions matter, and it's hard to come up with the right institution, market institution, that would preserve natural environments. So they're not being preserved. We have this bias, and we're getting increasing scarcity over time. A last consideration that I think is often overlooked but is interesting is that in this asymmetric technical change, there's a kind of path dependency going on. And he brings up this idea of learning by doing in the enjoyment of nature. So as we preserve wilderness, maybe the values will actually get higher, because people will invest in fishing skills and so forth, skiing skills, whatever it is, to be able to partake in the outdoor recreation and get more enjoyment out of it. They'll only do that if there's a commitment to the future, that in the future those resources will be there. So he wrote Conservation Reconsidered, 1967. In the same year, the Supreme Court handed down Udall versus the Federal Power Commission, backed the Snake River in Idaho, where the Hell's Canyon was. A new proposal for more dam projects further downstream from those old ones that had been considered in multiple purpose river development. Again, a controversy between different versions of what kind of development would be. Federal government and other parties suing one another. Eventually goes to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, The Supreme Court argued that, look, the whole record is about which dam project is the best, but no one has ever looked at whether or not there should be any dam project. We cannot assume that the only purpose of the federal water laws is to give value to the licensee or to build as many dam projects as possible. It has to be in the public interest. What's in the public interest includes the value of wilderness and anadromous fish and so forth. So the court remands the decision back to the Federal Power Commission to re-decide the case, not just in terms of which project should be built, but whether any project should be built. Crutilla enters this process, testifying before the FPC as a friend of the court on behalf of the Wilderness Society. He introduces some ideas from Conservation Reconsidered and ideas that he's continuing to develop at RFF with Tony Fisher and Charlie Cicchetti, work that would be published in the AER and other places. And he basically makes an argument like this. On the horizontal axis there, if you can see it, we have T for time. And on the vertical axis, we have D for development. If, hypothetically, you could imagine a path where the level of development could go up and down. So heuristically, maybe the preservation value of wilderness is constant over time, and say the development value varies with the business cycle or something like that. If you could imagine that, then the instantaneous flow of development would be going up and down over time, and if you could just look at that, it would be D star T, the thicker wavy line there. But he argues that's impossible, right? Because development is irreversible. Once you pay for paradise, you can't bring it back. So if we had something like D star T, instead we would go, given the irreversibility, the development path, the optimal development path given that constraint would be D of T, the smoothed out line, right? So the peaks, you'd smooth down, and the troughs, you'd smooth up a little bit, and you get those flat portions. Then comes the empirical portion of the argument. In fact, it seems like, over time, as he argued in Conservation Reconsidered, The development value is going down while the preservation value is going up. So what would D star T look like if that were the case? It would be only the downward portion of the D star T curve, right? That would always be going down. But it's the downward portions that are impossible. So what do you get? You get what in programming you'd call a bang-bang solution, where there's some development at the beginning, and then you preserve. You, as Pinchot would deridingly say about Muir, you would lock up the resources in its preserved state. And Kutil is arguing that's what should happen in his testimony, that that's what should happen in the Snake River. So what happens between 1958, when he writes Multiple Purpose River Development, and 1967 to change the landscape too much? Three important things. First, there's a new post-war environmental politics that environmental historians have emphasized, a new emphasis on the environment as a kind of consumptive good, a kind of aesthetic consumerism where we enjoy the natural environment around us versus an emphasis on the productive material inputs. The whole country is moving that way towards a new way of thinking in terms of consumption. You can see that all over American politics. So the consumer price index, right, becomes one focused on the expenditures of consumers rather than just the price of goods. Along with that, you have a new bureaucratic management of preservation. So game managers, for example, just swapping out their shingles for wildlife managers, right, renaming themselves to focus on concerns with preservation. So there's a political awareness of those concerns that's reinterpreted in a consumerist kind of way instead of the spiritual way of Muir. The second thing that happens is that there's new work at RFF and other places on non-market valuation and stated preference, work that could make Krutila's concerns, you could imagine that it would be empirically relevant given that new work. And third, there's a new definition of economics in terms of opportunity costs. So in the beginning decades of the 20th century and the late 19th century, all the definitions of economics were in terms of something like material welfare, right? Or business concerns and work. When you define economics in those terms, in terms of categories, then the natural environment doesn't look like economics, right? So you see people like the economist surveyed by Pruitt, like Krutila in his early work saying, okay, that preservation stuff, that's not economics, that's something else. Because economics is about material stuff. That's all something else. In 1932, Lionel Robbins famously suggested a new definition of economics, the one we're all familiar with, of competing uses for scarce means, competing ends for scarce means. That was proposed in the 1930s, but it's not like as soon as it came out, economists said, ah, you're right. That's how we're going to define our discipline. It took some time. And historians looking at that have found that it wasn't really until the 1960s that that definition really took off in the textbooks written on both sides of the Atlantic and in the way economists were thinking and talking about their work. That comes in the 1960s, so it's not surprising that Krutila is thinking about the opportunity costs trade-off between development and preservation at the same time as, say, Gary Becker can start thinking about the opportunity costs of time and the economics of crime and all sorts of things that would not have been economics until it was about opportunity costs. It's that thinking in terms of opportunity costs and in the way that Krutila thought about it that made it possible, I think, to think in terms of an economics of the environment. With an old way of thinking, you have something like on the left, you still see something like this in popular discourse sometime, where we have a trade-off, production possibility frontier, between economics, understood as material welfare, and the environment, right? So you got economics versus the environment. I'm sure you've all been confronted by that trade-off. If economics is material welfare, then yeah, that's the trade-off. But if you come to think of economics as being about the trade-off, then it comes off the axis and governs the whole trade-off itself. You have an economics of the environment, which is thinking about material wealth versus the environment. I think that's the most important legacy that Krutila and Conservation Reconsidered has given us. Thank you.
So Carrie and I took the liberty of putting me on this panel too. And I'm just going to speak for about 15 minutes on policy. So John was motivated by policy. We're all motivated by real world policy issues. And so I'd like to just take a few minutes to provide a little bit of the policy context at the time of the writing, which Spencer did a little bit too, and some points that John made in the article, and then in about cover about five decades and 5 minutes, and then talk about where we are today. And as was just pointed out, this could have a developing country context. It could have, we could talk about climate change in the context of conservation reconsidered. I'm really going to focus on conservation, land conservation, and public lands, with one slide at the end that goes a little bit beyond that. But obviously, when we talk about policy, we can mean a lot of things, and this is a fairly narrow focus. But it was John's focus to some extent, so that's going to be mine here as well. So the first thing I want to point out is that Crutilla said policy was really ahead of economics on this particular issue. So again, I'll read a quote from the, as Spencer did, from the paper. The central issue seems to be the problem of providing for the present and future the amenities associated with unspoiled natural environments for which the market fails to make adequate provision. While this is certainly consistent with recent public policy in regard to preserving natural environments, the traditional economic rationale for conservation does not address itself to this issue directly. So he was saying, hey, we're doing this in policy. We're just not really, we don't have economic models to look at it. And so I want to talk about what was going on with policy. And, you know, a lot of you know this, but some of you don't. So a little bit of history. There was a very influential presidential commission set up by Eisenhower, the Outdoor Recreation Resources Review Commission, which was highly influential. That's a photo, very dark over there, of John F. Kennedy getting the report from Lawrence Rockefeller and the commission. He was the chair of the commission. That very influential report established the Wilderness Act led to establishment of the Wilderness Act in 1964 and the Land and Water Conservation Fund Act of 1965. Very, very important pieces of legislation. And I will reference this little paper at RFF for a little more history. I'm not sure if Spencer's read that paper, but it's a really useful to describe a lot of the events of those days. And then not long after, we had the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act in 1968, which was directly because of damming of rivers that act was developed. So to preserve rivers in their wild state. And then, of course, all of our other very important laws came right on the heels of conservation reconsidered. So that was the policy world. And what John thought was going on, but economic models were not really speaking to these things. So what happened next is what I want to spend, you know, five decades, five slides, or 5 minutes to talk about. And I want to just give a sense of what I'm trying to do here is give a broad brush sense of sort of where we are now versus then. This is so a few graphs here and there in these slides. This is Land and Water Conservation Fund appropriations over time. So right after the act passed and through the 70s, we spent a lot of money acquiring lands to protect. So the fund is used for national park at land acquisitions. It also, there's a very active state grants program that has dwindled. So look for your little Land and Water Conservation Fund logo the next time you go for a hike. I just saw one last Saturday at Seneca Regional Park in Virginia. And it's really, the act has preserved a lot of parkland. And been very important. In recent years, it's much less significant. So I'll say more about that in a minute. Just want to also point out, and again, for those of you that don't know a lot about public lands, these are the four main land management agencies in the U.S., and this is how much acreage they have through the decades from the 1950 through 2015. And the main thing I want to point out is not the very high BLM lands than the blue, which have hold steady at about 250 million, and of course they're the largest landowner, land manager among the agencies, and the Forest Service is next. But I want to point out the two, the growth in the National Park Service acreage and Fish and Wildlife service acreage, which has grown by fourfold and ninefold from 1960 to the present. So we've added a lot of parks. We've added a lot of national wildlife refuges, highly visited sites. So this has been a big change since Crutilla wrote his paper. And then I really want to emphasize some very important changes that have happened to the landscape in the 90s and the 2000s. And that is we've got a whole lot more conservation programs. So we did a study, and this was, I'm a little out of date here, but things are probably about the same, in 2009, in which we tallied up 32 federal programs focused on spending on conservation. And 20 of them came about in the 90s and 2000s. And these are things like the Conservation Reserve Program and Wetlands Reserve Program, and there are a whole bunch of others. And one thing those programs are really doing is shifting more towards conservation and away from recreation, and much more towards the use of conservation easements on private land and away from public land fee acquisitions. And there's been a huge growth. This has been consistent in state programs as well. There's a lot more state programs, many of those focus on easements on private land. And there's been a huge growth in the land trust movement. So that was a very small thing when Crutilla wrote Conservation Reconsidered, but he did mention it. So he was skeptical about it. And he said, where a small natural area in some locality in the United States is threatened, the property is often purchased by Nature Conservancy, but this market is grossly imperfect. So he envisioned, sorry about the microphone sticking up there, he envisioned problems with, quote, comparatively large tracts of land with value beyond local interests. All of the problems of organizing a market for public goods arises. But this market has grown tremendously. And the Land Trust Alliance says that 56 million acres have been conserved by land trusts as of 2015. My question, I think, is do these private conservation lands provide the kind of option and existence values that John was envisioning? And I just leave that as an open question. Many of these are not, you don't have public access to. If I have an option, strong option values, you know, for lands I might want to visit, do they satisfy that? And, you know, it's an open question, I think. But we've really had a shift. Another shift, I won't spend time on this, is now we vote and spend money by voting on local ballot initiatives. And so that's a relatively new phenomenon as well. This is from the land vote database, which some of you have worked with, and that's total funds approved in local ballot initiatives for conservation. So that's another new, really new thing since John wrote. And then I want to come back to federal lands. So especially Bureau of Land Management lands, and this is going to lead me to a few comments about where we are right now. So just a few changes. The BLM lands as Forest Service are multiple use lands. So they're managed for mining, oil and gas development, outdoor recreation. They include wilderness areas, which are supposed to be roadless and undeveloped. Grazing, livestock grazing is a big thing on BLM lands. In 2000, the National Landscape Conservation System was established, which is kind of not a very well-known thing, but it set 33 million acres of those lands are recreation conservation is prioritized on. But at the same time, we've had this shale gas revolution and a lot of drilling on public lands. We've had, on the flip side, a decline of coal. Most of our coal, majority of our coal in the U.S. comes from public lands, and that's declined. And then the economics of ranching has also been on the decline, and grazing on public lands is a huge thing. So I'm bringing up these things kind of quickly, but in my mind, BLM multiple use management mandate is becoming increasingly challenging. And so that leads me to a few what I'm going to call public lands gathering storm, although in 2017, the storm may be here. Now I'm talking about sort of the last few years, although some of these things are endless. You know, people who have been around know that there have been these sort of problems over time. But I think they've have kind of reached a little bit of a tipping point in recent years, and that's a lot of issues in the West around property rights. That's a photo of the Malheur National Wildlife Refuge occupation you might remember from almost 2 years ago in Oregon when armed ranchers mostly and others took over a wildlife refuge, and it ended in a mess. And there was a court case, and they were absolved. And you know, it's all about private property rights and the feeling that there's too much federal land ownership in the West. That's also behind the movement to transfer federal lands to the states. So there's been a movement afoot in the West, and you Westerners know about this, I'm sure. There's been model legislation developed in several states. Utah, New Mexico, Idaho have had bills introduced in their legislatures to transfer federal lands to state ownership. They can't make that happen, but nonetheless, they're passing these or introducing these bills. It was part of the Republican presidential platform. So it's sort of, you know, simmering. I don't think that will necessarily go anywhere, but there'll be a lot of battles about it. There was a lot more debate over reauthorization of the Land and Water Conservation Fund Act in 2015 than people thought there would be. That's a very bipartisan program, lots of support because it's money spent in communities. It existed for 60 years, came up for reauthorization, and it was reauthorized after much debate for only 3 years, so it comes back up in 2018. And then there's Obama designating national monuments, and he designated 29 new monuments and expanded some others, adding 550 million acres. Now, a lot of that is in marine areas. 470 million of that is in marine national monuments, which is kind of a new thing. And this just stoked the fires a bit, I think, with some of the property rights folks and the we have too much federal land folks. National monuments, for those of you that don't know this real well, are designated. The Antiquities Act allows the president to designate national monuments unilaterally. National monuments, many of our best, most beloved national parks started as national monuments. The Grand Canyon did. Acadia did, a Grand Teton. So, they are typically managed by BLM, but some are managed by the Park Service. What happens when you designate a national monument is existing uses stay, but new extractive uses are off limits. So there's no oil and gas development, essentially, and no mineral development on these lands. And therein lies a bit of the tension. Some of the ones that are most contentious at the moment are in Utah, where the state of Utah kind of has a lot of its own dynamics. So here we are with those issues in 2017. And again, I'm talking about BLM lands again. And the Trump administration, as you probably all know, is increasing public lands resource extraction. There's the moratorium that Obama had put on coal leasing on federal lands has been lifted. That was a temporary moratorium, but that was lifted earlier this year. In July, Secretary Zinke of Interior announced that BLM would hold quarterly oil and gas lease sales and said, we're going to issue permits within 30 days. Didn't like this lengthy delay on permit issuing. So there's a few things going on. Some of you, Alan, may know more about what's going on with this. That photo in the middle is actually near Teddy Roosevelt National Park in North Dakota, where drilling is really, it's a very interesting setting. There's drilling right at the borders. And it really is affecting, I think, activity. There's a real conflict in some locations, and that's a particular one. And then there's this movement around the Antiquities Act. And so there are several bills in Congress that are saying we need to change the Antiquities Act, put limits on the number of monuments a president can create, require congressional approval, require local input very explicitly. And let me say this, there's a lot of local input to these creation of these monuments, but nonetheless to codify it in the law. And then Trump announced in late April that there was an executive order that there should be a review of all national monuments over 100,000 acres that had been created since 1996. That review, I think, has been completed, but is not public. I'm looking for Ben Simon if it's public yet. Not public yet, okay. But there's been some stories in the press, and, you know, I'm not sure exactly what this review is contained. That's a picture of Bears Ears National Monument, one of the last ones designated by Obama and one of the most contentious ones. So the thinking here is that and there will be court cases about this, that these will end up being, this will be fought in court. There's an open question about whether a president can rescind a monument, and that's, we'll probably see the courts decide that. So a few comments from me. In Conservation Reconsidered, Crutilla argued that the potential losers from development of, quote, a grand scenic wonder or a unique fragile ecosystem, or beneficiaries from preservation of those places, were unlikely to be able to influence the decision of a private landowner in their favor by their aggregate willingness to pay, and at the same time, the resource owner may not be able to compensate the losers out of the receipts from development. So this was part of the paper where he's talking about why, okay, there's an option value. We have markets for options. Why don't we have markets for this option? And he's explaining that, you know, that we don't think a resource owner would be able to compensate the losers. And so I just wanted to point out, I believe this resonates today, and maybe in a slightly different way, and this is just my take on some of these tensions in the West. And I personally feel that the aggregate willingness to pay for preservation is high, but geographically diffuse and not easily captured, whereas the potential losers from preservation, and these, you know, I'm not sure they're actual losers, but they feel like losers, and these are local communities that may forego lease revenues, what they feel are jobs from mining and oil and gas, are geographically concentrated, vocal. And so we have this kind of, you know, large benefits, but diffuse. It's sort of a political economy story, I think, in a way. And we'll have to see how this plays out. I want to just shift and say two final things on my last slide here. Two final kind of policy issues, and I think somebody hinted at these in the last, in the comments. And this is on this asymmetries in technological progress. So again, Spencer already brought this up, but I'll just read this. John said it is improbable that technology will advance to the point at which the grand geomorphologic wonders could be replicated or extinct species resurrected. Nor is it obvious that fabricated replicas, were they even possible, would have a value equivalent to that of the originals. The supply of natural phenomena is virtually inelastic. So where are we today? I just want to put two things on the table here. One is, and again, there might be others in the room who can talk more about this. I know Jim Boyd has been thinking about this issue of synthetic biology and genetic engineering, and this is here. And is the supply still virtually inelastic? We're talking about re-engineering extinct species. And what is the value of an engineered species? Can we conserve nature through technology? I think these are really interesting questions. A second point is there, in Conservation Reconsidered, it said there's a new class of problems to deal with related to the, again, I think Spencer had this quote up as well, the irreproducibility of unique phenomena of nature or the irreversibility of some consequence inimical to human welfare. Now, he might have been talking about damming a river, but the issue of the day is climate change, I think. And so the irreversibility point resonates, you know, to all of us, I think, but certainly to me more than ever. And I think we'll have some more comments about that later from Daron and others. That's it. Thank you. Before I introduce John, who's going to talk first, I want to, I was remiss, and I want to be sure and thank our financial sponsors for this event, which without which we could not have put it on, and that's the Sloan Foundation, the US EPA, Environmental Defense Fund, and actually the Wilderness Society, a small donation in because John was a member. So thanks to them. So we're going to have about 25 minutes for each of our three speakers and then take questions after that and discussion after that. So we're going to not do it after each speaker, but at the end. So first up, John List.
So I want to start by saying, Margaret and Carrie, thanks for putting this on. This is a wonderful event. And Speaker Spencer, Daron, and Eric, thanks a ton for taking part in this. So when I first got the invitation from Carrie, I thought, okay, how should I exactly construct my 45 minutes that I have to talk and my 100 slides? So where I decided to start was what I call a stroll down memory lane. And from there, I want to highlight two of my own research areas that Cretilla really had roots in developing. And as Spencer said, which was correct, there were so many ideas in there, you probably could have taken 100 different routes that he's helped develop. I'm just going to focus on two, because one is of current research interest to me most especially. And then I'll close with some statistics that I've gathered about our profession's view of Cretilla. Some of you may have been surveyed in the past several weeks. That was my team doing the surveying. Okay, so turn back the clock. 25 years ago, I'm a graduate student at the University of Wyoming, and Ralph Darge tells us to read Cretilla. And I made notes, in fact, and I found those notes, actually. And I'm going to zoom in on what I actually wrote back then as a second-year graduate student on this paper. Cretilla, 1967 AER. I bring out that first quote. Persons who obtain satisfaction from mere knowledge that part of wilderness North America remains, even though they would be appalled by the prospect of being exposed to it, page 781. And then I brought in Weisbrod on option value, and I argued back then that this was fundamentally different. That's what I was trying to say. So even back then, I was an experimentalist. So I said, what's a thought experiment? Why have not markets emerged? Was the first question I asked. Not great English, but nevertheless, I still asked it. How important are these passive values existence? How to measure? And then he goes down, and this was brought up by Margaret, willingness to accept is greater than willingness to pay. Is this more for unique goods and services, I ask? And I'll get back to this in a moment. Now, as I go down a little bit further, I talked a little bit about genetic variation values and fabricated, which is exactly what was mentioned. I actually mentioned learning by doing, which Spencer brought up. Now, here's where the really big fun starts. So in here, I say, no math, no model, but deep thinker, like Akerlof, 1970, must have been how they wrote back then. And I ended right there. I'm done. Now, down here, I have PD. That means what Professor Darge said. So Professor Darge, I'm going back here. You can see the next page. He did some mass balance stuff, which was kind of fun. That was brought up as well. Ralph says, 1989, court blessed existence values. CV, only game in town to estimate total values. Is CV reliable? That's where the paper ended then. Now, for me, back then, Cretilla was the man who dared to think nature could actually have a value. And during that class, a quick paper that we actually wrote up as classmates, Mike Margolis, Ann Alexander, and Ralph and I, within that class, wrote up this paper, A Method for Valuing Global Ecosystem Services. That's where we kind of got started in thinking about how to value ecosystem services. Now, more broadly, the influence of Cretilla really was in two big areas for me. And the first one was in non-market valuation. Okay, now it's been said here several times that really what he set in motion was a reason for contingent valuation, a reason why we needed something beyond revealed preferences was because of the things that Cretilla talked about. Weisbrod as well, I don't want to minimize his contributions, but Cretilla in terms of existence values. Now, CVM to do this, of course, is a preferred approach of many, but not all. There are critics in the room and there are proponents in the room, and I don't want to get into that debate today. Now, I want to step back and talk about what is the simple model behind current ways to do CV. and then talk about how we can amend those. So the simple model pretty much goes as follows. There's a tax, tau, and that tax can improve a public good from Q0 to Q, and the respondent receives some utility, let's say from consumption of numerair in the public good. Now, from the perspective of the survey respondent, you are essentially thinking about whether to vote for or against the project. Now, as the model goes on, we have to assume this is going to be important, though, as we move forward, additive separability, and it's linear in consumption. You essentially look at P, or what's called your pivotality term, or your consequentiality term. You can think of consequentiality and pivotality in this particular case. And you're essentially voting yes if this term here is greater than zero. That's your simple choice in a referendum. Now, the implication here is provided that P is greater than zero, these responses will measure what we're interested in. And that has been a big bone of contention, is that assumption. It's a bunch of Richard's recent work, and Richard and I have worked on a few papers as well, thinking about how to make sure P is strictly greater than zero. Now, several critics have come forward and talked about the worst parts of CV, and it tends to come in two forms. One is hypothetical bias. Even though P might be positive, people still might view it as a hypothetical choice. Another critique is, well, those votes might be more than the value V of the public good. They might include these other types of terms. And Jack Kinesh has been mentioned several times today already. Jack has done a lot of work in this area, but there are many other forms that this vote could take: warm glow, expressive utility, social image, and the like. So as the argument goes, those features might infiltrate CV statements, rendering clean measurement fruitless. That's this typical argument that you hear in the literature. So today what I want to talk about is, can we formalize those elements and embrace them and incorporate those elements into the standard model, which of course can include existence values, and still retrieve values for V for the public good? That's what I'm going to propose that I am currently trying to do in my research agenda. Now, this is what I call opening my laptop. So open it up, and here's what we have. A very simple augmented model is to assume that this new term, call it S, this reflects these effects that we care about, these behavioral effects. Let's label them as behavioral. Now, the question is, again, I'm assuming additive separability in each component. You vote yes if that term is positive, where S equals, this is your social image from voting in favor, social image for voting against. I'm just assuming for convenience here that that difference is positive. Okay, so now we're looking at that term rather than the term without the social image concerns. Now, the implications of doing that is, even when you have consequentiality, even when P is greater than zero, no longer are you confident that the voting behavior maps into your valuation of V. So just by adding that term, that will cause the voting behavior not necessarily to map directly into V. Now, on hypothetical bias, as I mentioned, hypothetical bias is a big, big area in this literature. The hypothetical bias sign actually depends on the relationship between the value of the public good and the tax rate, tau. In very interesting ways, actually. When it's a good public good, so to speak, an increase in pivotality will increase share voting for the program. When it's a negative, it actually decreases share voting for the program as you increase pivotality. Okay, so now here you can think about, if I can exogenously change P, I'm going to get a sense of whether that's a good public good or not. Now on social image, what falls out of this simple model is that there's now a direct connection between hypothetical bias and social image. And the intuition is that as this component, as social image grows larger, as pivotality shrinks. So as P goes down, the importance of social image will go up. And that's basically by design. So now a key question comes down to, can we augment the way in which we typically use CV to recover values of public goods even when these behavioral motivations are present? So i.e., can we identify V if that's the model that people are using when they vote? And of course, the answer has to be, given that I'm presenting it, yes, you can. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here presenting this. I'd present some stuff on Uber or something, how Critel has affected Uber. The important point here is that you need experimental variation in P and in tau. In the moment you have that, you can identify V and S separately in that simple model. Okay, so here's a sketch of the identification proof. You have people who you want to fill out the survey, and you simply just have to put them in one of four programs. And how I'm labeling consequential and hypothetical, I'm just assuming P consequential here is greater than P hypothetical. Okay. And all I'm doing is I'm varying the tax level, and I'm varying the probability that your vote is pivotal, and that trick will allow you to identify V and S. Okay, now how do you do that? You recover the two probabilities by simply looking at the difference in vote shares between 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. And the intuition is right down here about how those fall out naturally. Now, once you have those probabilities in hand, you can solve for V simply by looking at the tax level for that equalizes the vote share between hypothetical and consequential. And that crossing property will give you V. So intuitively, here's what's going on in this model. If we assume that S is 1, I make two assumptions on probabilities here. This is a consequential, this is vote share over the tax. This is the consequential line, this is a hypothetical line. The solution here is where they cross, that's the unique value for big V. Okay? Now, just a little side note, you can extend this to have a stochastic V. This is a work in progress, as I hope I've made clear. Now, there are important assumptions here that I should mention. This model will not be identified if pivotality varies with the tax, if S varies with pivotality, or if S varies with the tax, unless I assume some parametric forms. I need those things. I need additive separability is really super important here for this model. So let's put this into action. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this study, which I don't know what to call it. I'd like to call it a famous study because a few of the co-authors are in the room, actually at least 3, 4, 5. We try to put a value on the BP oil spill. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that and run basically a pilot on what's called Qualtrics, which is basically MTurk. Okay, now the research agenda, we will also go and do door-to-door samples, but what I'll talk about today is just the data from MTurk, just to put this idea into action. So we start by looking at how are you going to establish wording for the consequential treatment. I'm essentially going to follow Erwin Bolte et al., and this will be my language. I have two prices in this pilot. And then this is a consequential statement down here. Please know that the results of this vote will be shared with Dr. blah, 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 blah. That's the typical way in which this literature thinks about trying to make something like a vote consequential. Now that will be crossed with a hypothetical treatment. Exactly the same up on top, but we're trying to induce hypothetical bias here, so we say please note that this is a hypothetical vote, not a real one. No one will actually pay a tax at the end of the survey. Do you vote yes or no? This is our simple way of trying to use our machinery and our structural model to estimate these primitives, this V in the model. So here's a quick summary. We estimate those. We match the empirical moments with the theoretical moments. We're assuming that S is normally distributed. All other parameters are deterministic. And what we find is that when we don't have S in the model, we get a V of about $150 per person. When we include S in the model, we reduce it by more than half to 68.6. Now, I can't remember what was our preferred estimate. In the science paper, what do we say is our preferred estimate? Yeah, this is the low one. The low one. Are these in the neighborhood? Okay.
It's reasonably close.
Okay. So MTurk gives you a reasonable estimate, and this tells you exactly what V is worth and exactly what S is worth. Now, we can debate later about whether we want S to be included. We can talk about that, whether that's appropriate. And I think that's a good discussion to have. But what I'm trying to put out here is that we can have a model with these behavioral modifications and still estimate V and S in a pretty efficient manner. Now, the takeaways here essentially is I hope that this kind of research can allow us to go beyond battles about what these things do and embrace these aspects of, if we have them in a model, how can we use field experiments and experimental variation combined with economic theory to say something about the relative measures of things that we care about, like V and S. Okay, so that's research area number one. How much time do I have left here?
10 minutes.
Okay, good. This should be perfect timing. Research area number two is something that may be partly fabricated by me, what I read in his work, but nevertheless, a few of you have brought up the fact that willingness to accept might be greater than willingness to pay. And he has those exact words in his paper when he says maximum willingness to pay may be significantly less than the minimum which would be required to compensate such individuals. Now, when I look back at my notes and when I look at papers that I've written since then, the way I interpreted his statement was essentially that there's some resource that in fact has a real income component. And if we recognize that real income component, we will have a divergence between willingness to accept and willingness to pay, sort of like an income effect, is a way at least I interpreted it back then. Okay. Now, there are a lot of alternatives to thinking about existence values and what Kurtilla gave us that can lead to different paths for a value disparity. And one is just that it can generate a kink. What Bill Schultze and McClelland and others talked about in their AER paper, that if intrinsic values are included in willingness to accept but not fully included in willingness to pay, it will theoretically look like a kink in the indifference curve. The way I think about Michael's nice work in 1991 is we can think about existence values causing indifference curves to be more convex to the origin, and we have to think about if existence values become more and more important, does that cause the divergence to become greater and greater? And I think the initial intuition of that idea, even though I think he was talking about income effects, is also manifested in just the idea of existence values leading to greater convexity. Now, what I want to talk about here is I won't go through a specific paper that I'm working on, but what I want to go through is the way I see how the literature evolved since 1967 and where we are today, because I think it's a beautiful sense of the give and take between theory and empiricism, and also the different types of ways we can think about generating empirical estimates. Okay, so the way I think about how this started is you have Cretilla, Mailer, Willig, come a little bit later, and you have these early CV surveys that find evidence that willingness to accept is greater than willingness to pay. Now from there, you have some really, really neat lab experiments by Kahneman et al. Shulgren has a nice paper, and they find key supporting evidence for this idea that WTA is greater than WTP. Then you have some more theory. Michael's great piece in the AER, Randall and Stoll. And then from that theory, we go to the field. This is sort of where I enter. I think about running field experiments in real markets where people do not know that they're taking part in an experiment. Can we find this value disparity in those markets as well? What I find is it's alive and well, but market experience attenuates the value disparities considerably. That the really high experience people do not have the value disparity is what I find in those three papers. Now, people then took that and went back to the lab and said, can we replicate the result that List found in the field? And by and large, you can replicate. Market experience is super important to overcome this, quote, behavioral anomaly. Now, from there, people started putting subjects in tubes. So this is my paper with Tong et al. In PNAS, where we give people market experience in trading, and we look at how their brain activity changes when they trade. And indeed, what happens there is that as you gain market experience, you start to code your trades in different parts of the brain than when you're inexperienced. In fact, you code them in parts of the brain that's not associated with losses. That's fortuitously, that's sort of what I argued back here, is there's some psychological impact where people can overcome coding a trade as a loss. And then along comes more theory. So Kojegi and Rabin put together some very nice theoretical models talking about endogenous reference points, how we can use that endogeneity to predict what policies will do, how people will behave, how we describe behaviors. And now I haven't put this down, but number nine could be going out and using this idea of loss aversion or endowment effect or WTA greater than WTP to actually induce people to work harder for you. We've done this with teachers. We find that when you use these types of incentives, teachers work harder during the school year. We're using it for millions of Uber drivers as we speak. They're getting incentives up front, and then if they don't perform, the incentives get taken away. This is all an idea about how to use this value disparity to essentially make the world a better place. So I'm going to close with a few thoughts, and Spencer hit on a few of these. When you look at the great economic contributions in the 20th century, I think this will go down as one of them. Why? Because it challenges conventional economic thinking, which was economics versus the environment, to environmental economics. That's clear. That's really hard to argue against that point. Now, this is going to be discussed at length in a bit, but he talked about how technological advance and irreversibility can actually make a resource more valuable relative to extraction. I think that turned things around on its head as well. Now, I have to put on my Chicago hat. I also went back and reread the paper. And now as a Chicago economist, I actually felt that Cretilla was speaking to Milton Friedman and the Friedmanites, who at the time were arguing, look, there's no need for government, as you could have guessed what Friedman would have argued. There's no need for government. The market's doing this just fine. Now, I don't know if this has been maybe the people who he knew well. I never met Critella personally. Maybe they can speak to this later, but I just got the feeling that there was an unwritten dialogue between him and Friedman that could have been going on when he wrote this paper. Now, if you think about intellectual histories, and Nick did a really nice job writing about this in 2007 at the 40th anniversary, it would be really hard not to include Critella as a key player in our intellectual history of our field. There's just no doubt about that. So I ended up taking that to the test. And I ended up asking myself, you know, because my guess was when Kerry asked Darone and Eric to give talks, my guess was they had never even heard of Critella. And they had been trained in a way that I believe Critella's thoughts were in the training, but they had probably never heard about the paper. But they had heard about Akerlof, who I compare Critella's work to, and Coase, as Spencer brought up. So I decided to do a little bit of background. Now, it's always dangerous to talk about sites, so I don't want to dwell on this, but the citations that he has are really broad-based. What was really interesting, 500 different journals and 91 non-English studies, which I think must be some sort of record. Now, we know, however, that that's a clear understatement because his ideas are affecting reasoning and ways of doing things. I could have cited him probably 200 times, but I probably have cited him once or twice, even though his line of thought has affected my own scholarship. So when you look at, I thought that this was amazing because the number of studies citing Critella has actually risen over time. It's really quite surprising to me. I thought this was just going to die on the vine, so to speak, but that's certainly not true. And when you look at the breadth, which is really interesting, you know, there are a lot of environmental studies, and across a lot of areas, people are still citing Critella's work. So I think the breadth of the scholarship is really astounding. Now, I took to the streets and did this survey, which I mentioned at the beginning. I contacted 30 institutions, and I wanted to find out if people are actually teaching Critella. And I got 20 responses, and here's what I can tell you. General trend is that this is being taught, but primarily outside the U.S. Now, it is taught in kind of interesting courses, one cultural economics course and one ethics course. The paper is literally being taught. And in the U.S., Yale, Santa Barbara, and UC Davis are still using Critella's paper. Now, in general, I think most people would say what I just said is that the ideas permeate our textbooks and our research studies that we are putting out there. So essentially, Critella is there, but yet he's invisible when you look at names. And I'm going to end here because I think this is a modal feeling of these respondents. John Critella was a pivotal force in the early decades of resource economics, trying to push the field beyond just resource management for market goods. I think it is fair to say he was a towering figure. By looking at his citations and his coverage on syllabi, you will vastly underestimate his contributions. His ideas weave through every environmental resource growth, ethics, conservation, and law course. And I'm going to end there and say thank you very much for your attention.
I'm going to walk over here and I'll talk loud. I have a confession to start with. I'm a macroeconomist.
A recovery one.
I'm not the only one here, but I am the only one here who's probably never worked in any aspect of environmental research in my portfolio. I did not read Critella in grad school. So the question is, why am I here? Why did Kerry and Margaret and John think that I should be talking to you today? And I do a lot of work on valuing non-market activities via revealed preference in a variety of other settings. So they thought it might be useful to have me chat a little bit about how some economists are trying to value non-market time in other types of settings. So, as I went through Conservation Reconsidered, you could you know, we've talked a lot about this already today, about trying to measure the benefits of protecting natural resources. And to do so, we could use a transportation demand system that has kind of followed along in some of the work that has come after. Do you need me to talk in a microphone?
Yeah, the video can.
Oh, they can't pick me. I can try standing there, but I look really guilty when I stand someplace and talk, so I'll try.
Bob Barker.
That's easy. At least I can wander a little.
Is this ready? Oh, wait, that's loud. So now I'm not going to talk as loud because your ears will hurt. So the thinking about the inputs into these travel demand functions is time. So that was kind of the way we were trying to measure the cost that people were paying for some leisure activities. It could be good. I'm going to talk, a lot of my work is going to be measuring a variety of leisure activities, not only leisure activities associated with natural resource. And so when we think about measuring the opportunity cost of time, you immediately want to go to your wage, the cost that you're giving up in the market for forgoing a unit of time to actually allocate to some other activity. And when you start thinking about how people measure the opportunity cost of time, sometimes they take the wage rate and kind of take a haircut off of it, maybe one-third of the wage or one-fourth of the wage or one-half of the wage. And, you know, the reason we take a haircut, I'll talk a little bit on the next slide, but that kind of goes against theory to some extent, where the theory on the margin, at least from going back to the Becker use of time, is literally the wage rate, not the wage rate minus 2%, not the wage rate minus a third, but the wage rate itself. Because on the margin, we could always decide whether to go to work for an extra hour at our market wage or then allocate that unit of time to some other activity. So why might the market wage not be an ideal measure of the opportunity cost of time? And one is we just don't have wages for many people. Okay, so if there are people who are retired or children or out of the labor force, we don't have an observed measure of the opportunity cost of time. So that isn't a useful even construct for those individuals. Second, and I think this is an important one, at least the one I believe most, is that constraints are important and that my market wage that I earn on whatever job I am at this moment might not be what I could earn on the margin if I wanted one more hour or one more unit of time. There are some sort of fixed cost to me getting a job. So the wage rate might be an upper bound on the opportunity cost of time for other uses of my time. And then again, that cost, the wage itself, includes other potential even variable costs, such as travel time and taxes or other kind of factors that might affect how much my marginal productivity is as well. And then I'll talk a little bit, this is the last thing I'll say in the prelude, and then we'll get into what I do. And it also, the concept of just the full employment, the full income that Becker had out there, where the wage is your measure, is a powerful construct, and I'll kind of walk through a little bit in a second, but it's simplistic in other senses, and it doesn't allow us to kind of easily measure innovations in other leisure activities that might affect our marginal utility over time. And I'm going to try to do a little bit of that today. So what am I going to talk about? I'm going to try to show how one could use at least some simple economic theory combined with detailed time use data. And I think that's kind of the hallmark of the work that I try to do, is use detailed data on how people allocate their time to infer one's opportunity cost of time that we could then put into our model. So it's going to be very different than John, who was trying to think about existence values in some sense. And I'm going to use revealed preference to try to back out another component of how people value certain types of non-market activities. And I'm going to, again, talk a little bit about my research doing that. And then I'm going to discuss some of my new work, trying to estimate the marginal value of leisure in a model with different leisure activities. So how do we infer changes in leisure technology in utility terms from, again, some revealed preference choices. So I'm going to try to do both of these. So let's start with trying to value people's non-market time through revealed preference. And I'm going to do some of the work in this first part on the opposite side of leisure, another non-market use of time, home production. Okay. So we think on the margin, people are still going to allocate their time in margin terms across all non-market uses. So one non-market is recreational activities, and another non-market is home production. So I'm going to use some data on and some theory for home production to infer people's marginal valuation of time. And I'll show you what we could learn from that about how these marginal valuations evolve over the life cycle and across different types of people. So I'm going to steal willingly from Becker, and this is from Becker and Ghez, to talk about consumption that enters our utility function. So we get utility out of C. Okay. This consumption is going to be some combination of market inputs and expenditure and time inputs that we put together with that. So from now on, when I say X, that's going to be the money you spend on a given activity. H is going to be your time input into that activity, and you're going to get some output, some production. We're going to call that the consumption that enters our utility function. So if I want to make a dinner at night, I get utility out of the dinner, and it's going to have some groceries, and that's going to be the X, and it's going to have some H, that's going to be my time chopping things and throwing them in the oven, and then I'm going to get the meal out of that. Okay, and I'm going to specify with a little bit of structure, okay, a functional form such that the relationship between time and money are going to have some constant returns to scale. Okay. And what does that mean? It means that I could boil down the elasticity of substitution between these goods to a parameter like, I'm just going to call it sigma. Just take the derivatives across that production function I give you, and you could get the intra-temporal elasticity of substitution, how much we're willing to trade off between time and money in a given production of something that enters our utility function. It could be some parameter, sigma we'll call it. Okay? And that could be good specific. Okay? The sigma for food, you know, a meal might be very different than the sigma from recreational activities. And actually in my work that I do with Mark Aguirre, I actually define leisure goods based upon the production technology. Leisure goods are by definition goods for which time and money are complements with each other. Okay? So when you think about TV watching, time and money are complements. I can get a big screen TV, but I can't get my enjoyment of watching Game of Thrones by paying you to watch it for me. I need to put my time input into those types of goods. And again, many of the recreational goods that we're talking about, valuing natural resources, time and money are going to be complements with each other. Home production goods, on the other hand, time and money are substitutes. I could pay you to come in and clean my house or cook my meal for me and still get the same amount of utility. Okay, so with that, you could take the first order conditions of this model, and I didn't do all the gory details from that for you, but with a little bit of algebra, you could get a first order condition that boils down to the fact that if I observe how people change their consumption spending, okay, their money spending, the X, and how people change their time spending, the H, that's going to be related to changes in the opportunity cost of time, that omega, in this elasticity of substitution. And so if I have any three, I could back out the fourth. And why is that useful? Because sometimes in different settings, we might be able to have measures of X from data, measures of H from data, and maybe one of the other two. And then if you have the third, you could always infer the fourth from this first order condition. Now, like John said, there's some structure implied upon this. And I put a functional form on this home production technology, and that buys me a lot. But in doing so, if you grant me that, then I'm actually going to go to data, and I'm actually going to try to measure the X's and the H's, and then try using other types of methods to try to either get the sigmas or the omegas. So what are the X's? The X's are easy to get. Okay, there's lots of data over long periods of time on how people spend their money. The Consumer Expenditure Survey in the United States goes back consistently measured through the 1984 with earlier iterations of that in, you know, the 70s and the 60s and such. So we have good measures of how people spend their money. And now even in panel form, micro surveys of the household, like the panel study of income dynamics, the health and retirement survey, have measures of expenditure. At the same time, we have administrative data. People are getting scanner records and credit card data to actually measure how people spend their money on very detailed categories. The new innovation, which some of you might know about, but others may not, is we also now in the US have very good time series measures of how people allocate their time. So starting in 2003, the American Time Use Survey has started measuring time use for about 10,000 households per year for how they allocate their time in 400 and some very detailed time use categories. And the way it's set up, something is not always ideal. It's a one-day snapshot with a 24-hour budget constraint. Okay, so every hour of your day, it's actually 10-minute intervals of your day, are filled in on how you're allocating your time. So if you over-report something, by definition, you must be under-reporting something else because your day is bound by 24. It's a one-day snapshot. So what you did yesterday might not be representative of your life, but if you group that into individuals by age, by education, by gender, you could get some power on how people are, you know, a representative person in a different group might be allocating their time. Okay. So what I've done, okay, I'm going to show you now kind of how I've used this to talk a little bit about life cycle savings, inferring something about people's opportunity cost of time. Okay. So the first thing that I do, I'm going to use this equation. I'm going to use it in my work with Mark Aguiar in our AER piece in 2007. We actually use this to explain life cycle spending, in particular for food spending over the life cycle. There's a big literature, or it was a literature at a time, how people at the time of retirement suddenly decrease their spending. Okay, and people were like, people don't save enough for retirement. And our point was, well, maybe they're just substituting time for money, and that's helping to sustain consumption during the retirement years. So we have data on people's food spending. We have data on how much time people spend cooking and preparing meals and such from those time use data we had before. I'm going to have a measure of the opportunity cost of time I'm going to infer from other time use data, which I'll tell you about in a second. And then we could back out this elasticity of substitution for food production. Okay? And we get a number like 1.5 to 2. It's time and money are substitutes when people are making their meals. So I had two. Okay, that's kind of a general thing. I used the same thing in a precursor paper in 2005. To actually infer how the opportunity cost of time has changed for retirees. So I can use data on actual food intake. So now I have three things in that production function. I have the X, I have the H, and I have the C itself. I can measure what people are sticking in their mouths and intaking for their food. And from that now, if you give me that sigma, the home production technology parameter, you could then infer the opportunity cost of time. And so I use this data on these food intakes and the data on time spent cooking, on money spent cooking, to infer that the average retiree, on the moment you retire, has an opportunity cost of time about half the person the day before retirement. Okay, so it looks like when you become retired, your opportunity cost of time gets a haircut of a half. Not a third, but maybe a half in how people allocate their time. So that's kind of useful. Again, it says that on the margin, when you're not working, you can't go back to your old wage and on the marginal hour earn the wage you were earning when you were in the labor force. So there is a haircut, but it's not one for one. In that 2007 paper again, I'm going back to that, how did I infer the opportunity cost of time to get the sigma that we talked about before? I observe people's shopping behavior. So how am I going to use data on shopping to actually infer people's opportunity cost of time? Well, I'm going to infer how much they're shopping, but I also observe the prices they're paying. So then I could get the return for them actually spending another hour shopping because you could look for better bargains and you could get a lower price from that. And from that, again, I need a little structure on that shopping function, okay? But from that, you can infer how the opportunity cost of time evolves over the life cycle. Now, it looks like the wage. It's hump-shaped, just like our wage kind of declines a little bit sooner maybe than it was in the pure wage data. But you could see through this that the retirees, okay, or people as they age towards retirement, have an opportunity cost of time of about 25 log points lower than somebody when they are about 25. So you see the opportunity cost of time is evolving over time. Now, but so is the wage. So maybe we could go back and then see how the haircut that we will want to put into our model evolves over time. So the key thing, again, the takeaway from this is that, again, revealed preference and good data on how people allocate their time away from the market allows you to infer something about people's opportunity cost of time, which we then could put into models and help value things like how much people like certain types of recreational activities. Now, this is not model free, okay? The estimates are definitely based on some structure, and the structure buys something. So thinking hard about how sensitive the results are to the structure you put in is an important part of this process. But some structure could go a long way in order in leading towards some estimates. And I think it has benefits above and beyond the full income approach for the reasons we talked about before, such that the wage on the margin might not be allocated for a given person. That they can't just make that, the wage, you can't just go and work one additional hour to get that wage. Okay. And again, the data that we have on time use now is much better than we had in the past. That makes these inferences a lot easier than they would have been before, because we just have large samples yearly on how people are allocating their time to get power in ways that we wouldn't have had before. Okay, so let me do one last thing quickly about another aspect of my most recent work that I think is going to be useful for how people could evaluate leisure types of activities. And so I'm going to draw now on my work again with Mark Aguiar, but also Mark Bills and Kerwin Charles, to talk about how we could use, again, a little bit of structure in data on how people allocate their time to infer innovations in leisure activities. So this is a paper, some of you might have heard about it, like in newspapers, but not like the actual economics of the paper, about how video games has influenced the labor supply of young men. Okay, so that's kind of some work I've been doing now. But the heart of that paper, okay, you might, there's something pop about that, you know, the press seems to like, but the heart of that paper is developing a leisure demand system, a demand system in time space that we could then use to infer technological progress in leisure activities. And what I want to do now, just in a second, and I'll kind of walk you through one bare bones component of the model and then show you some of the results, is in your mind, you should think about this as being analogous to a traditional demand system in money space that we've been using for long periods of time. A demand system in money space is, I got a certain amount of income. How do I allocate that income across different types of consumption, expenditure, goods? How much goes to food? How much goes to housing? How much goes to recreation, etc.? So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to create a demand system in time space. If you have a given amount of leisure, on the margin, how much do you allocate to, you know, video games? How much do you get TV watching? How much do you go to exercise? How much do you do to outdoor recreation, etc.? Okay, and let me, the reason I'm just showing you this now is this is, again, for the paper, this isn't about spending time outside. This is more about spending time inside. But young men's leisure, these are, again, young men in my paper, is 21 to 30-year-olds. Leisure has gone up by about 2.5 hours per week during the 2000s. Okay, a lot of men aren't working. As work hours gone down, leisure has gone up. You don't see them cooking more. You don't see them going back to school more. It's showing up in leisure. Of that increase in leisure, 1.9 hours of that 2.5 hours went to video games or to computer leisure activities alone. And 1.5 hour of that increase went to video. So this is kind of what was motivating us. You see a big sharp shift in how people are allocating their recreational time. Again, I'm doing this through the leisure activities of computer time because that's kind of what I've done, but it extends to any type of potential leisure activity we could think about. So here's one slide just on the model nuts and bolts, just to kind of get a sense of kind of the structure I need. Again, like John, I need some structure. And like John, I'm going to apply to weak separability between consumption and leisure in order to generate a little bit of, a lot of bit of simplicity in my estimating equations. So here's, people get preferences, in this case, of consumption directly. So there's no home production here. So C is basically X. You spend money on some certain goods, and then you're going to get consumption out of a vector of time uses. And those are little h's now. So the little h is going to be how much you tend to spend time on a bunch of different leisure activities. So I'm going to assume that there's weak separability between these consumption and leisure vector. There's some technology that is out there that translates a unit of time into a unit of utility. And I'm going to call those thetas. Okay? And that's why I want to infer how these thetas might be changing over time, whether certain leisure activities are becoming more enjoyable or more productive in utility sense than other types of leisure activities. And I'm going to actually specify the leisure function over on the top right of that screen. So basically, that has another strong assumption that these leisure activities are linear, well, separable with each other in utility. Okay? That the amount of marginal utility I get on how much outdoor recreation I get is independent of how much time I spend on video games. So there's separability across the leisure activities. And each leisure activity, and this is the key part of our assumption, and I think it's something that, you know, makes the demand system interesting, the different leisure activities have different diminishing returns. So some activities have sharp diminishing returns, other leisure activities have relatively weak diminishing returns. And those eta's vary by leisure activity. Okay. So with this structure, I'm going to jump ahead. You could generate something that looks like these leisure angle curves. Okay. So what are these leisure angle curves? And how can we use them to infer changes in technology for a given leisure activity? So on the x-axis is how much leisure time me, the individual, spends in total. So that's the capital H, the sum of all the little h's. And the little h is how much I spend on a given leisure activity. I'll call it capital I in this case. And then again, in the paper, it's how much time young men are spending on video games. And suppose we have the slope of this line. And what is the slope of this line? It is the diminishing returns in this activity relative to basically the weighted average of the diminishing returns on all other activities. So how much there is diminishing returns in this activity. So some activities in our nomenclature in the paper are leisure luxuries. What does that mean? A 1% increase in total leisure time leads to a more than 1% increase in time spent on that activity. Other activities are leisure necessities. Now, what we do in that paper, and we do it, for this video game activity. We actually do it for lots of activities, but not particularly outdoor recreation. But we do for a bundle of activities. We try to estimate the slopes of these leisure angle curves using cross-region variation during the Great Recession. So we see, and again, the identifying assumption means there's a guy in Nevada who lost his job, relative to a guy in Texas. And we're going to figure out how he allocates his time. And the identifying assumption is the guy in Nevada lost his job or is working less than the guy in Texas for things unrelated to changes in their preferences for leisure activities. Okay? So a housing bust comes along, puts the guy in Nevada out of work, but not the guy in Texas. And then we trace out how they spend their time. And once they trace out how they spend their time, we could get the slopes of these curves for different leisure activities. And that's what we get. The slope of the computer activities we get is like 2. So it's a big leisure luxury for young men. And we see that a 1% increase in these young men's time of total leisure time, they increase their computer time by 2%. Sleep was like 0.6. TV watching was 1.3. Okay, hanging out with friends was like 1. So you could do this activity by activity to get these slopes of these angle curves. Okay, so then what do we do? Okay, I'm almost done. I got like 2-3 slides left. And so then what we do is then we go to the time series data and see how much young men were actually spending on their total leisure time in some pre-period, 2005, relative to how much they're spending on computer time. And we just fit that on the line. That gets us the slope of, the intercept of that line. And then we use the time series change for young men and ask, in 2015, when young men have more leisure time, are they sliding along their angle curve, or does it look like the angle curve shifts? So you might ask me, young men might be playing more video games just because they're working less. And I say, perfectly true. The slope of that line tells us how much video games they should be playing if they were working less, if you believe my identification. In leisure time of young men went up about 4% during the 2000s. Okay? The slope of that line is 2, so it says their computer time should have gone up by 8% if they're just moving along the angle curve. But in the data, we see young men actually increase their computer time by 50%. So the only way our model reconciles that is that there's been some relative increase in the preferences for this activity relative to other activities during this time period. And then with a little bit more structure, okay, instead of just getting the relative changes, maybe get the level and then how it affects labor supply, then we could come back and do a little bit more of what the paper was designed to do. But for our perspective today, we could use this, a little bit of structure, revealed preference on how people allocate their time, and some sort of variation that we might have in the data, like regional variation or something like that, to trace out the slopes of these curves. And then when we start seeing people changing the allocation of their time over time, more or less than we would predict by these preferences, we could learn something about changes in the marginal valuation of these leisure activities. And that's kind of what this paper was about. Okay. That was just the summary of the paper, if anybody was interested. We find a modest effect on labor supply of young men from these increases in computer technology. Okay, so I'm done now. So again, the key thing for my work that I think is kind of what I think about in lots of aspects of my work is how we could use real preference to infer the value of non-market time. You need some structure. Time use data is essential because that's going to be what you could observe on in the choice that's going to help us pin down people's preferences, at least, again, existence values is hard, but at least their observed actual actions tell us something about how much they value these non-market activities. And I think it's exciting to explore future applications of this in many other domains besides kind of what I've been doing. I'm done.
It's a pleasure to be here. I am one of those people that John rightly anticipated that I had not read Crutela before, but I'm very glad to have made the introduction, my own introduction to him, and it's actually I can see why it's so thought-provoking, and it's sort of filtered through other things to my own imperfect knowledge base. But I am an imposter in terms of environmental economics. I never took a course in environmental economics. I was interested in the issues, but the sort of issues became more relevant for me as I started thinking about the applications of some of the ideas that I had developed in other domains into the field of environmental economics. So, key locus for that is technology. So I'm going to talk about gifts and burdens of technology because I think there are very important elements that make technology crucial but also somewhat dangerous for thinking about the environment. So the overriding conservation problem of the day, in my opinion, but I think this is not a minority opinion, is conserving the environment, conserving the climate from man-made climate change. And I think there is general agreement in the climate science literature that technology has an important role in this in one way or another, but technology and its endogenous evolution are still absent from most analysis of climate change. In fact, Crutela's work does recognize the importance of technology, and in fact, he also talks about the asymmetric effects of technology or asymmetric technological change that happens at different rates in different subsectors of the economy, which is going to be an important theme I'm going to come to. But that also takes technology as exogenous, and I think the key here is the endogeneity of technology. So, in fact, what I'm going to argue is that technology can be a very potent force for limiting climate change. And, in fact, change, which is a little surprising because I'm going to take a very canonical model of thinking about the climate, and I'm just going to change one feature related to technology, and pretty much every implication of that model for policy is going to change. So it's very consequential, at least if you buy into the way that I will argue it should be modeled, both theoretically and empirically. But it also changes both the criticality of getting policy right, both its timeliness and magnitude of the intervention. So I'll talk about that. But it can also turn from a gift into a hefty burden, because technology, when not used properly, can deepen our problems, either through the wrong sorts of policies or through inaction. And I'll actually explain why the promise of technology together brings a temptation for inaction that actually is quite important. Okay, very quick overview. The critical person in our thinking about the climate change, of course, is Bill Nordhaus. His seminal work is really a very, very simple and very clean framework, where you take a model of capital accumulation, however you do that, exogenous or endogenous savings. Originally, he was using a sort of a solo model with exogenous saving, but that doesn't matter. But you augment that with two equations, one equation that links the production, either the capital stock or the output, into pollution, say carbon emissions. It could be different types of pollutants, but let's just think of it as just carbon for simplicity, say CO2, ignore the other types. And then another equation that's, that links future productivity, and that could be future utility. And I always found this a little bit awkward, that Nordhaus always does this through the production side, and I thought, well, we care about the environment through our utility function, so I'm glad Cortilla really was there and emphasizing that. But Nordhaus does it from the production function because it's easier to discipline with data, I guess. And those two equations, then you get an endogenous model in which production capital stock, together with a carbon stock in the atmosphere, because there are the equations that sort of how carbon is depleted and is being absorbed by the forest cover or by the oceans, et cetera, and then our productivity because of the effect of the quality of the environment or the concentration of carbon in the atmosphere. Then you can use this sort of for policy. So you can say, what are the costs and benefits of environmental policy? So if we introduce environmental policy, it's going to distort otherwise undistorted margins, so reduce capital stock investment, so there will be some cost in terms of economic growth, but also there will be benefits in terms of reducing the pollution, which then improves future productivity. So using this framework, actually, you can embed in it very distinct views, and it all depends on things like risk aversion, what assumptions you make about the value of the environment, the quality, how the quality of the environment or carbon enters into the productivity of future generations or our utility function. And the one that's dominant in economics, and for better or worse, we all take it as our baseline starting point when we do quantitative work, for example, are the parameterization that Nordhaus used. And it gives actually not an alarmist view. It sort of starts, you know, of course there should be Pigouvian taxes, but those Pigouvian taxes are not very high, and they also have a ramp up because you don't want to hurt yourself right now because of discounting. You start slow and you sort of build up the intervention over time. That's sort of sometimes called ramp up. But even the long run intervention level is not super high. So that could be contrasted with what, for example, sort of the implicit belief in, you know, Al Gore's public interventions, which have been actually quite useful in some ways, or Nick Stern's, important report prepared for the UK government, which I think was also very, very useful. But, you know, when you go to the bottom, for example, Nick Stern's report, the assumptions are very, very similar to the ones that Nordhaus makes, except for discounting. So the discount rate is taken to be smaller in Stern, so that you actually care more about future generations. And then you end up with larger interventions a little bit sooner, more immediate, but also significantly more severe long-run costs. Or you can go even further. You can make the quality of an environment or the weight you put on future generations even higher, and so that any reduction in productivity for future generation is very penalized, and then you're going to get you're going to get some sort of view similar to the Greenpeace or the Sierra Club, which says growth has to stop, because if we keep on growing, we're going to keep on polluting the environment. That's going to take us towards sort of more dangerous territories. So against this background, here is this one paper that I'll start talking about, which is my work with Philippe Aguillon, Leo Burstein, and David Hemus, which was published in AER 2012. So essentially what this does is that it incorporates into the Northhouse model a endogenous and directed technological change. Directed technological change is essentially what I've been working on since the mid-1990s. At some level, I had experienced it, directed technological change, which means that the ability of agents on the ground to change where they do technological innovations or effort. I've seen that in other areas change the conclusions that we reach quite a lot. So, you know, my previous work applied that to labor markets, to pharmaceuticals, to other aspects of economic growth. And that sort of endogeneity really reverses a lot of the intuitions that you might have had otherwise, depending on details, of course. But generally, things like demand curves sloping down may no longer be true. Comparative statics might change. Welfare effects might change. But I wasn't actually expecting how fundamentally the implications of policy in these baseline economic models would change. So here is the way that we did it, and we did this because of simplicity. We took just the simplest possible approach you can do so. You can use for sort of getting to the bottom. So two imperfectly substitutable production techniques, dirty and clean. For simplicity, let's assume clean doesn't generate any carbon, perhaps extreme depending on what you want to put in the clean, and the dirty generates carbon as it produces. And epsilon is the elasticity of substitution, just like Eric, you know, CES is very convenient, but I'll come back to explain why it's not a great assumption in this particular context in a little bit. Carbon emissions then create an environmental externality. So as everybody in this room knows better than I do, of course, we're going to be thinking about Pigouvian taxes. But here, there are two margins. Either you can tax dirty production so as to reduce dirty production, perhaps shift some of it to clean production, but also you can try to improve clean production. Okay? So technology is going to be endogenous. And this is going to at least give us a way of thinking about transitioning to clean energy as one of the options for dealing with climate change. And in fact, here are the key assumptions. One, there is a scarce resource, let's say scientists, that society is going to allocate to improve the technology of the two types of production. So for example, half of your scientists can work on dirty, you know, they can try to improve the internal combustion engine or efficiency of coal mines or oil rigs. I mean, oil rigs technology has improved, you know, by leaps and bounds, for example. Or they can work on inventing, improving the cleaner technologies, geothermal, biotechnology, solar, wind, wherever you want to put nuclear. And so there are these two technology terms summarizing. The model has a more microstructure, but you can aggregate it up to some parameter, let's say AC, that's the quality of the clean technology, and AD, that's the quality of the dirty technology. In equilibrium, firms are going to make maximizing decisions that's going to determine where scientists work. And second key assumption is that there are within technology building on the shoulders of giants. What does that mean? What that means, and this is critical, is that when you improve clean technology today, that gives you more options for improving clean technology tomorrow. So it's a form of learning by doing, although not assumed exogenously, but it comes from the structure of the research. So if you are trying to compete against the internal combustion engine with an electric car, and there are no electric cars, and nobody has invested in that technology, that's going to be really hard. But after 20 years of investments in the electric car technology, then you've improved it enough that your productivity could compete with it. So that's one within technology building on the shoulders of giants. So in particular, we're going to assume that this process can go on, you allocate scientists to clean or dirty technology, benefiting from this within technology buildings on the shoulders of giants in an unlimited way, day in and day out. There are also no technology limits. It's not going to say, okay, you've come to this level, you're going to stop. And that's, again, sort of plausible because, you know, otherwise growth would not take place. All these features are not unreasonable. That doesn't mean they're exactly true, but they're not unreasonable. So, for example, in work I've done joint with Ufuk Akçigit and Bill Kerr, where we mapped the innovation network, so you can see what the citation patterns of different patents are across different technology classes. And in fact, you see that there is a very meaningful topology to that. There are sectors that are close to each other. They cite each other's work. So that's building on the shoulders of your local giants. Of course, reality is more complex than just that happening. You also sometimes start citing patents from a totally unrelated field because you are doing this kind of recombination of ideas across fields. There is also this sort of building on the shoulders of giants in a specific energy-related area, the car technology. That's a work that Philippe Aguillon with co-authors has done and published in the JPE 2016, finds evidence for this that, you know, in response to changes in the EU policy on car emissions, you have these responses for different types of car engines being developed, and there is this pattern of building on previous advances in clean technology, for example. So what are the implications? So here is a summary of the main implications that are very different, and I'll explain in what way they are different from the benchmark framework I started with and why they are different. The first is the form of optimal policy. So a basic theorem in public finance says tax the thing that creates externalities and only the thing that creates externalities. Okay? So in a world with competitive markets and nothing else, if there is one activity, say carbon emissions, that creates externalities, then basic public finance theory says you should have Pigouvian tax on carbon emissions and nothing else. And that's actually what guided Nordhaus. Nordhaus's basic framework considers only a single policy instrument, a carbon tax. And if you go to Stern's report, that's essentially more or less there. You know, Dick was a public finance economist a long time ago. And you can interpret, you know, the sort of the Greenpeace Sierra Club view is like just have such a high level of carbon tax that that would do the trick. But here, the result is very different. You should always have two instruments, not a single one. First, a carbon tax, of course, the Pigouvian tax is necessary, but plus subsidies to clean research. Why is that? Because clean subsidies redirect technological change from dirty production, where it would naturally go, towards clean production. But once you improve clean production, you improve your future trade-offs. So if you did not use subsidies, what you would want to do as an optimal policy is that you would want to charge a carbon tax way above the Pigouvian tax, which would be prohibitively expensive, at least according to some people's utility function. So the clean subsidy essentially enables you to reduce the carbon tax back to the Pigouvian level. And what's going on is that there is, of course, another externality. It's a hidden externality. It's a hidden externality because if you did not have the environmental constraints, you wouldn't need to intervene at all. So without the environmental constraints, so environmental externality, you would have no need for a Pigouvian tax, and you would have no need for a clean subsidy. But as soon as the quality of the environment has a shadow value, that shadow value actuates a need for changing the future trade-off, and that's why you want to use the clean subsidy to redirect. That's the first fundamental difference from existing models. The second is the timing of optimal policy. Under fairly reasonable parameterizations like the Nordhaus's, optimal policy should take this form of a gradual ramp up. And the force for that, as I mentioned already, is discounting. You always want to have a little bit of a party today and delay the costs to later. There's nothing cynical about that. That's just preference for earlier than later consumption. But once you recognize the importance of directed technological change, that changes. Why? Well, actually, that changes that you actually want immediate and large intervention right away that could actually decline over time. So the time path of intervention is reversed. Why is that? Well, because the problem is to close the gap between clean and dirty technology. And every day you don't intervene, dirty technology pulls ahead. It's one day wasted, and it's worse than wasted because you actually increase the gap that you have to close. So you have to do more work. So you better do it right away. And in fact, the costs of delay could be quite substantial. Why temporary? Why then not start big and go even bigger? Well, there is a temporary thing. The reason why you're using this clean research subsidy in particular is to actually change the trade-off for the future. But once you give enough subsidy and the within technology building on the shoulders of giants gets strong enough, clean technology has become as good or even better than dirty technology, then you don't need to subsidize it anymore. But at that point, the shadow cost of carbon declines also. So you can actually reduce both types of intervention at some point, not 10 years, not 20 years, but perhaps, you know, 50, 60, 100 years. Third, the cost of optimal policy could be actually quite minor in the long run. So in Nordhaus, they are moderate, but they grow over time. In Stern report, they're high. They may even grow over time. Here, they could be quite small. In fact, they could be zero or negative in the long run. Why? Because what you're doing is that you're doing a costly transition to clean technology, but then you can grow quite well with clean technology. And it could well be that clean technology actually has some features in terms of its linkages, for example, that would generate spillover onto other sectors, that long-run growth with clean technology might be better than with coal. I'm not assuming that, but if that's the case, long-run cost could be even negative. So it's actually, even though it's required for immediate and quite significant interventions, it's not a pessimistic story. The balance of policy is also sort of interesting, and this is somewhat surprising, and this is not a theorem. Everything I've told you so far is a theorem. This is sort of back-of-the-envelope calculations. Somewhat surprisingly, actually, you get relatively moderate carbon taxes, provided that you do aggressive enough clean research subsidies. Why? Because once you do the clean research subsidies well enough, and it actually works out, and I'll talk about the constraints on that in a second, you know, you're back to the Pigouvian tax. And the Pigouvian tax, taking into account that in the future you're going to take care of this trade-off, may not be that high. And then finally, and you're already seeing here, this is not my main burden, but you're already seeing the burden of technology here, is that there is actually a negative dark side to directed technological change. If you don't do anything, the same forces are going to make the problem worse and worse over time. So that's the same point that I made with the immediate intervention, but I want to highlight it as a burden of technology. Because if you don't do anything, directed technological change implies that there is an incentive to keep on going on the technology that's already far ahead. So we're going to keep on investing in the internal combustion engine, in oil, in coal-powered plants, and so on. Now, what about exhaustible resources? So I didn't talk about exhaustible resources. Does it change the picture? Yes, but mostly no. Yes, in the sense that the market economy does a little bit better with exhaustible resources, perhaps funny enough. And that's because if the dirty technology uses exhaustible resources, there is a self-correcting mechanism that the price of the exhaustible resources can increase over time, and that can already create some impetus for changing from dirty to clean. But largely no, because that's never enough, that's too late, that's too little, and if you work out the optimal policy with exhaustible resources, it works very similar to the one that I've already outlined. But there are many assumptions into this framework, and there are many things that is, so it's a theoretical exercise, so you want to take that a little bit closer to data. But if you want to take it closer to data, the CES structure doesn't make sense. So what does the CES structure imply? For example, the CES structure implies that even if I make my clean technology as good as possible, precisely when I make it to as good as possible, I really have a very high valuation for dirty technology because they're imperfect substitutes. If they're imperfect substitutes, one of them goes ahead. Even if that elasticity of substitution is very high, the value of the other one shoots to infinity. That just doesn't make sense. So instead, you really need to have a more micro-modeling. In fact, this is a general sort of approach that I like very much. Instead of working with production functions, you want to work at activity level. So this is going back to some important contributions by people like Lancaster, for example, or Hotelling, in fact. This is not staying properly. Okay. So here, and that also has various applications in labor economics and in other settings. John and David Leibson and I have written a little paper about its implications in education production technologies in the context of labor economics. Working at the task level fundamentally changes how you want to think about the effects of technology on wages and employment, for example. But here, it makes a lot of sense, because what you want to do is you want to think about, can we substitute clean technology for dirty in lighting? Can we do it for factories? Can we do it for cars? Can we do it for air conditioners? And all of them have different technologies. All of them have different constraints, depending on, for example, the intermittency of or the efficiency of regeneration, etc. So this is the approach we take in the paper with Ofuk Akçigit, Doug Henley, and Bill Kerr, published in the JPE 2016. And we have a continuum of energy activities, and each one of them can be produced with clean or dirty technology. And then you have research determine the relative productivity of clean and dirty technology within each activity. So to start with, dirty technology is going to be ahead in all of the many of the lines. So the black is ahead of the green, but the green can leapfrog within technology. So ultimately, you can do everything with green, clean technology, but it's going to take a very, very, very long time. So it's a sort of a different conceptualization of how transition to clean technology can take place. So in this case, analytical results are a little bit harder. So most of it, most of what we do is quantitative and empirical, but it makes us capable of going to micro data. So in particular, now we can estimate parts of the production function using patents, production, capital, labor data for energy firms and R&D data, and also use some reasonable assumptions following Nordhaus to sort of embed this into a general equilibrium framework. So what do we find? First of all, the qualitative patterns of optimal policy are very similar in this more realistic setting. We do find support for building on the shoulders of technology, giants of your own technology. And optimal policy, again, needs to rely substantially on clean research subsidies. But now carbon taxes have more complex effects, and they may need to be permanent, or depending on social discount factor, they may need to increase. So overall, these are sort of these results are generally in line with the theoretical results, so they're sort of encouraging. But there are lots of flies in the ointment, too. There is a big assumption here, which is that these research subsidies are effective. But, you know, we know there are a lot of ifs there. So what if research subsidies are, you know, wasteful? Well, in the quantitative exercises are useful for that purpose. We can sort of investigate that. And it seems that even if, like, they are partially wasteful, so that 30, 40 cents out of every dollar you spend on clean research subsidies gets redirected or wasted, the qualitative picture is still very similar. But, of course, if they are totally wasteful, you have no way of influencing the direction of technological change, then all bets are off. But we know from various empirical work, including by Richard Newell, that there are market prices and government incentives that changes the direction of technological change. And for example, in the pharmaceutical industry, work I did with Joshua Lin or Amy Finkelstein did also find support for these sorts of direct technological effects changing with respect to prices and policies. But what if there are limits to what clean technologies can do? So that, I think, is a big thing. So all estimates are within samples. If there are hard limits on clean technology, of course, we're back to the exogenous technology world. So there is one big assumption that those sort of limits are not there. But again, I think that's not an unreasonable set of issues to entertain. So need for empirical work. I think that's key. I've cited a few empirical works, but not enough. So it's a very challenging area because this is not individual level work. You cannot just compare one plant to another. You can get some estimates for some parameters for that, but the really thing here is all general equilibrium, so you need to make general equilibrium comparisons. You can't even compare countries or states because the global environment is a global environment. But let me sort of not spend too much time on that because I don't want to eat into the time. for discussion. So I want to talk about the real danger. The real danger, as highlighted by these models, is inaction. So if you don't do anything, things get worse. But I will say this real danger is even more present once we think of technology. And that's because there is a natural set of factors within technological solutions that push us towards inaction. And that is that once we know that technology could be a solution, we have an incentive to wait for those solutions and not take hard, costly actions today. And that could be for three reasons. One is irrationality, and I'm not ruling it out at all. I think it's quite present. We fool ourselves with tales of easy transitions. Geoengineering is going to come and solve our solutions. Why should we do anything about it? Okay? So that means if we expect geoengineering in 10 years' time to solve all of our problems, why should we have high carbon taxes and reduce our production and local communities lose jobs and all that? But even more important, I would argue, is time inconsistency. There is a natural set of forces that the prospect of future solutions can make things worse if we cannot commit to future policy, and I'll explain that in the next few minutes. And political economy. So, you know, I spend most of my time, you know, more than half of my time on is political economy, and the other half is on directed technological change and technology and their applications in labor markets and environment. But here they actually meet. There are some very interesting issues, but I'm not going to talk about them today. But time inconsistency already starts giving you a flavor of what the political economy issues are going to be. So this is based on recent work, working paper that I have with a graduate student of ours, Will Rafi. It investigates the issue of time inconsistency in this context. So essentially what do? We take a model similar to the one that I've already outlined, which has investment in clean technologies. But we change two things. First of all, we get rid of the clean subsidies. So that's for simplicity, but it has some implications. So it's just carbon taxes are the only policy tool. But secondly, we make the social planner time inconsistent. You know that's going to matter to some degree, because if you actually work through the details of the models I told you about optimal policy, as soon as you work it out, you see, wow, this is a fairly time inconsistent policy. You want to announce this policy, but once people make their actions, you want to change it. So by time inconsistency, I just mean that. There is no commitment to future policies, so I announce a policy, but then I might have an incentive to change it in the future. And then what we also do is that we introduce geoengineering to this framework, which is that in the future, we may get technological breakthroughs that reduce the damages from carbon or that reduce our carbon emissions in a much less costly manner. What happens? Well, so this I just said that. Utilitarian social planner, without commitment, private investments in clean technology, just like I did, and the potential geoengineering. And the carbon taxes are the only instrument. So what happens is, I think, super interesting. Without the commitment power, the social planner is forced to set Pigovian taxes. But actually what the social planner, of course, wants is not set Pigovian taxes, set Pigovian high taxes higher than the Pigovian carbon tax. Why? Because you want to encourage the investment in clean technology for exactly the same reasons that I've outlined. So if you tie your hands to Pigovian taxes, you have an important loss. But more interesting are the comparative status or the implications of geoengineering. Now introduce geoengineering into this framework. What happened? We all know that, so there's no uncertainty. Let's imagine we're not fooling ourselves. We all really know that tomorrow there's going to be a geoengineering breakthrough. But what that does is that it reduces the marginal cost of carbon. So if it reduces the marginal cost of carbon, it reduces the credible tax that the social planner can commit to. But with a low tax, nobody wants to invest in cleaner technology. So we start undoing those effects. In the benchmark case, this is the simplest case, but captures the qualitative effects, you have to have a particular carbon tax. The carbon tax cannot fall below a certain level. That otherwise, everybody stops investing into clean technology or any sort of activity that reduces damages, and then damages shoot through the roof. So therefore, what happens if we reduce the effective carbon stock tomorrow by geoengineering? The only equilibrium is that our pollution has to increase, that the marginal cost, marginal damages are restored back to where they were before. What that means is that we have lost everything we gained, but perhaps more, from geoengineering. Why perhaps more? Well, we need to restore the marginal back to where it was. But restoring back the marginal might imply that the level may need to increase a lot. That will depend on the elasticity. If the elasticity is high, to go back to the same marginal, you need to increase the level by a huge amount. So what you end up doing is you don't improve the environment, you make it worse. You don't improve welfare, you make it worse, because you've just got a gift from Athena. So geoengineering now turns out to be a super costly thing, because it locks us into inaction in such a way that we make ourselves much worse and the environment much more damaged. Overall, the conservation problem is controlling the climate change to a large extent today. There are other problems, of course, they are important too, but this one is really an existential threat. And technology is a potent force here that has been long underexplored. Once you start exploring it, it's exciting economics, but its policy implications are perhaps even more sweeping. It increases, rather than diminishing, the criticality of getting the right policy. But it also highlights that if we don't do the right policy, those gifts of technology can turn into hefty burdens. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I want to thank our speakers very, very much for investing their time and energy in this program. I also want to thank you for coming. And I realize I'm standing between you and lunch, so I will keep these even shorter than what I thought I would. Good ideas change the way we think. We know that. Sometimes, as John List said, they become so ingrained in the way we think and do our work that we forget where they came from. Spencer reminded us where many of them came from, Conservation Reconsidered. That's important. One of the things I want to point out from Spencer's comments and from things John said, and I said this in the discussion of John's rejection of by the AER of Conservation Reconsidered initially, was one subtle change that he emphasized to me when I first went to RFF. And he emphasized to the editor in responding to the rejection. At the time, land textbooks discussed the allocation of land as a question of developing or improving it from an undeveloped or an unimproved status. Those words imply, as Spencer said, there is no opportunity cost. And it was his connection of that opportunity cost to the direction of economics, as Spencer pointed out, that was key. So thinking of development or preservation changes the whole way we think about things. Just tell them I'll be right with them. Sometimes good ideas actually change what we do in addition to the way what we think. I'm convinced Conservation Reconsidered and its ideas did that. But I don't want to go too far here. It didn't just happen. The reason it happened is because of you, all of you here, and some who are not here. You did it. John didn't do it. You did it. You were captured by the ideas, And you were the ones who made the change, not John. Okay? He gave us something that captured your imagination, but you made the difference. So I don't want to forget that, because it's because of you, because of Resources for the Future, because of others that couldn't be here, that we're able to give ourselves a collective pat on the back, as Richard said. I mean, last night, we're giving ourselves a pat on the back for what has been accomplished, okay? The Sloan Foundation, EPA, the Environmental Defense Fund, and the Wilderness Society gave us an opportunity, okay, to ask the question, are we finished? You know, have we done what the ideas stimulated us to do? And so the panel is about that. Margaret reminded us that opportunity costs come in many ways, and in particular, the decisions associated with land policy now. We can undo, we won't change the amount of land, but we can undo the protections that are associated with that. And those decisions are every bit as important now as they were when John talked about this. There's indivisibility, there's irreversibility, as Nick Flores said, John emphasized the heterogeneity in preferences and the difficulty associated with serving all those preferences outside markets. Inside markets, it's a bit easier than it is outside markets. Charlie Cicchetti reminded me of that last night. So what did the panel tell us? Panelists gave us mechanisms for using the tools at our disposal to uncover the elements in preferences that create that heterogeneity, whether it's the valuation of natural environments, whether it's the difference between willingness to pay and willingness to accept, whether existence value is an income effect, essentially an augmentation of our endowment because something is allocated a particular way, or should we treat it another way? And he gave us the mechanisms to uncover and extract this, conditional on his model's assumptions. And so we have S to recover. What I want to know is who decides whether it's a part of preferences or not. I believe in consumer sovereignty. So I'm prepared to redefine commodities and say, fine, I'll include S in welfare. John would say we can separate it and we'll put this to one side. I want to know who decides. I'm not going to answer that. I'm just going to say who decides. I'd know what I'd decide. Eric suggested to us that the market is not the only margin for learning about trade-offs. There are other constraints out there. There are other behaviors that we're recording, and we can use them, particularly if those records extend over time. So as I said, I was real interested in his leisure allocation functions because it seemed to me it was a way of getting at the evaluation of environmental quality change as we see changes in time use, or the evaluation of congestion, increasing congestion at recreational areas, or the evaluation of large shocks to the system and its ways that we, or I certainly hadn't thought about before reading Eric's papers. Theron told us that conservation of the atmosphere is the challenge of our time, and that what we do is especially important because of the path dependency, because of the situation that characterizes the starting point we're at, and that we may need multiple instruments. Several people, Partha in particular, identified the fact that our models still are incomplete in describing this, and he focused on materials balance and energy balance. The first Volvo Prize went to John and Alan, okay? to both of them for their contributions, for their shared Alan Canessa contributions to the environment. And the materials balance part is not incorporated in any of our models now. And particularly closing the loop associated with that connection to the environment. So clearly that's something to think about. The other question that kept occurring to me when I was thinking about the enormous advances that Daron's work has given us into the understanding technical change is, have we fully closed the system in the sense of who's paying for the subsidies? If we start thinking about this in the context of another literature that's familiar to environmental economists, namely the double dividend literature, if we think about it more generally, what would our verdict be? And I don't know the answer to that, but I'm certainly interested in learning it. Well, I think the answer to my rhetorical question, are we done, is no, we've just begun. And thankfully, we have all of you here and our panelists and lots of young people to help us along the way. Thank you very much.